for tonight. The title of this is Beyond Agency Theory, the Hidden and Heretofore Inaccessible Power of Integrity. This is something that I got started on, close to 15 years ago now. The foundation of this comes from the field of ontology and its associated methodology and phenomenology, which is probably totally strange to you as it was to me when I began to get started. So it's going to look a little, I'm not going to talk much about ontology or phenomenology, but I just want you to know that it comes from a very different place than economics. Why is it important? It's important because ontology is all about the science, it's the science and philosophy of being. And we spend all of our time, virtually all of our time, thinking about knowing and transferring knowledge to people under, in our educational programs, the absolutely false proposition that communicating knowledge to our students and our colleagues actually shifts their being. Like we think we're turning out managers, students who are being managers or being leaders. No. Knowing about managing and knowing about leading is not being a leader and being a manager. Nor does knowing about integrity make you a man or a woman of integrity. So one of the things that the talk I designed for today is designed to shift your being if you want to, so that integrity, as I'm going to define it, becomes who you are, if you choose to do that. So, enough about, pretty much about ontology. I'm going to come down there, because I hate standing up here and wander around down here. So, some of what I'm going to do today is going to sound weird to you. This integrity stuff is, as I said, I got started on in a pretty serious way about 8 years ago, and it's still developing. It is the most beautiful model I've ever worked with. Just no kidding. But that also means it's going to look weird to you. So it's clearly going to be outside, it's going to look like it's outside the domain of finance and economics, and in the sense it is, but it has huge economics and finance implications. 5 years ago, I gave a talk at the Orlando meetings of the FMA. It was entitled Putting Integrity into Finance, which I didn't put much emphasis on the integrity aspects, but more on the finance aspects. So today we're going to do integrity. And so it's going to be, it looks a little illegitimate. I don't have any problem forecasting that 10 years from now, integrity will be a mainline topic in financial research. It has huge implications. If you want to really start peeling it all back, we're going to discover that the root cause of the recent financial distress and the problems throughout the world really lies in the lack of integrity. As I said, the value increasing implications of integrity, as we're going to define it, is absolutely enormous. So bear with me. Some of it's going to, this language is going to sound quite different to you. It's pretty simple. There isn't any mathematics involved, which sort of puts me behind the eight ball anyway, but as most of you know, I've never done mathematics. And I've also seen people be very uncomfortable a number of other times in my career. So what do I mean by beyond agency theory? There's far too much concern about the conflicts of interest between people, I believe. That, for example, the conflicts between agents and owners or between any two or more cooperating individuals, historically a favorite subject of mine. Now, I believe we've made huge progress in resolving those problems. We've got a long ways to go. Consider, for example, the major improvements in governance around the world. The split between the CEO and chairman of the board is now close to complete in one way or another. control of the compensation and audit committees is now shifting away from the CEO, on and on. So if we've had so much progress with agency problems, why is there so much trouble in the world? There's way too little concern for the damage done to people and organizations by the actions of individuals that are not in those individuals' own personal self-interest. And that includes every single one of us in this room, including me. And we don't see it. And what I intend to do today is make those actions of ours more visible to us, so that we can see the difficulties we generate in our lives. So, these are self-control problems, if we want to think about them, agency problems with ourselves. I'm going to ask us to pay attention today to the integrity issues that cause huge problems in our lives as individuals, and to everyone we come in contact with, including other individuals, organizations, and society. The surprising fact is that the huge costs we personally bear from the lack of integrity are absolutely invisible to every one of us in this room. And by the time we leave here, if you choose to take it on, you'll be able to see some of that and actually take actions to change it. I can guarantee you it's had a huge impact on my personal life. And I'll talk about its impact on CERN. But because they are invisible to us as integrity problems, we have no access to resolving them. None. So I've said, behavioral economics and behavioral finance are making enormous contributions to our world. These integrity problems are the 800-pound gorilla in the middle of the behavioral finance and behavioral economics field, and they're invisible to that whole field of research. So how does all this fit with the Jensen-Meckling agency model? Think about it in the following way. I'd say that the agency problems account that we were talking about account for about a quarter of the conflicts of interest that's caused difficulties in the world. Integrity problems, the agency problems with oneself, count for another quarter of the conflicts of interest. People harm others at the same time that they harm themselves. And viewing these issues in the traditional agency framework gives us no access whatsoever to resolving them. None. And finally, the problems in co-locating decision rights and specific knowledge count for another quarter of the conflicts of interest and the damage that goes on in the world. And the remaining 25% appears to be conflicts of interest due to, as yet to me anyway, unknown causes that we don't know that we don't know. Now, we only need to read the newspaper for 5 days in a row to be clear that in every facet of life, we're losing the war on the battlefield of integrity. Everyone espouses integrity, but few live it, including everyone in this room, including me. And as I've said, they do not even occur to us as integrity problems. So before we go on, some of the people may have seen this before, I'd like to have us all take an awareness test. Watch carefully, because you're going to get graded on your answers. And if somebody will dim the lights, please, so that before I click the thing, I want to see the lights go down. Very good. Okay.
This is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
No!
Yeah, 13. But did you see the moonwalking bear?
No!
So, how many people, you turn the lights back up now. How many people got the right answer and saw the bear? Nobody. Maybe there's one or two shy people who did. That's usually, there's one back there. Yeah. Well, those of you that see it, seen it before, that's a little cheating, but you get the point. So, 90% of the people that take that test usually fail, and I failed it miserably. It relates to something that we call perceptual constraints. Well, most of us believe we see the world and what we're dealing with as it is. That, as we have just observed, is clearly false. Clearly false. And if you actually take that in and realize how little each of us sees of what's in front of us and we're dealing with. Now, if you can't, if we're not seeing what's actually happening in front of us, what is the likelihood that we can interact with that in a productive way? Zero. And all you have to do, if you want some close-up examples of that, is look at your home life, your marriage or something like that, your relationship with your parents or your children. Now, neuroscientists have seen and shown that we do not see what the eyes see. We see what the brain sees. If visual sensations were primarily received rather than constructed by the brain, you'd expect that most of the fibers going to the brain's primary visual cortex would come from the retina. Instead, scientists have found that only 20% do. 80% come downward from regions of the brain governing functions like memory. Richard Gregory, a prominent British neuropsychologist, estimates that visual perception is more than 90% memory and less than 10% sensory nerve signals. Now, why is this relevant today? We didn't see the bear because the announcer and I, through language, shifted the frame of reference you had for viewing the video. Language can do that for us. It shifts how we see the world, and we bring certain frames of reference to any situation, even if somebody isn't shifting for us. Now, I intend to do the equivalent today of rewinding the tape so that we can see what we do not see now regarding integrity. In effect, integrity is the unperceived bear in our lives, and my intention is to shift the parts of our worldview and frames of reference relevant to our view of integrity so that we see it differently, in fact, as it is. I'm going to do this by outlining a new positive model of integrity that allows things to show up that did not show up before. The intellectual point is that distinguishing something newly can make visible what was always there, but not seen. And in the case of integrity, will allow for new possibilities to show up in our life. Questions for the day. Do violations of integrity make any real difference to organizational performance, the bottom line, or the quality of organizational life? Do violations of integrity make any real difference to your performance, your bottom line, or the quality of your life? What is integrity? For an object or a system, for a person, or for an entity across the spectrum of entities from family through organization to society? What conceals the impact of integrity on organizations and individuals? We want to communicate a new language to deal powerfully with and provide actionable access to the effects of integrity on organizational, market, and personal issues. We're going to distinguish integrity in ways that involve no normative aspects whatsoever. None. It's nothing good or bad about it, it just is. We're going to distinguish the law of integrity, which, like the law of gravity, operates whether you like it or not. There's nothing inherently good or bad about gravity, but if you attempt to violate it, step off a four-story building without some kind of safety device, it's going to hurt when you hit the bottom. And that's what the way the law of integrity operates. Now, almost all of us think of integrity as related to ethics and morality. I'm going to show you what that relationship is. But what you got to get to start with is the way we're going to define integrity in the law of integrity has no normative aspects whatsoever. In that sense, it's like gravity. I'm going to reveal the effects. So I'm going to distinguish integrity as a hidden and critical factor of production, equivalent importance to labor, capital, technology, knowledge, and strategy, and one that is invisible to economists and most businesses, and invisible to all of us as individuals. We're going to reveal the effects of integrity on the performance of individuals, groups, and organizations, including its effects on the quality of life. And then I'll distinguish ethics, morality, legality, and sincerity from integrity, and show how they relate to integrity and therefore to performance. Now, we've got a lot to do. And along the way, I'm going to provide you an actionable pathway to integrity, show you an effective and fast pathway to being trusted by others. You know, trust is something that happens over there, not something that happens here. So I'm going to show you how to generate trust, and it's very valuable to have that. We'll show how applying a cost-benefit analysis to your integrity virtually guarantees that you will be out of integrity. And yet we all do it. This one I spent a full year struggling with. How could it be that cost-benefit analysis doesn't give you the right answer? It drove me crazy for a year. I'll spare you the whole story. But, and it guarantees that you will be an untrustworthy person. I will show you why, despite the damaging consequences, people generally behave in ways that violate the law of integrity and thereby reduce their performance and quality of life and dramatically limit their opportunity for performance. And finally, I'll give you access to the power to reject this path. A warning. I'm going to stretch everybody here today, but especially economists and ethicists, if there are any in the crowd. What we're talking about is highly relevant to and complementary to economics, business management, and ethics, but it's not economics, and it's not ethics. Its roots are in ontology, the nature of being for human beings. And specifically, what we're going to be dealing with is what does it mean to be a person of integrity? Integrity is one of many ontological laws of human nature that provide effective access to the so-called people problems that drive us crazy. And I intend to make them a legitimate part of finance and economics. It will literally transform what we do in business schools and our educational programs dramatically. And it will dramatically affect the students that we're turning out. The things that won't be affected very much are the tools courses, the courses that teach present values, calculations, and linear programming, and stuff like that. But all the rest of it eventually is going to change, but that's another discussion. So we're not going to go into detail about that. It may upset some of you what I'm going to be saying, much like what Michaeline and I saw regarding our agency paper from our colleagues at Rochester. Now, Bill was the dean, and they ran us out of the room when we gave that first paper. They hated it, and then they called us names. They said we plagiarized that. It was on and on. My teachers and friends at the University of Chicago Business School ran me out of the seminar room. They hated it. Oliver Williamson was the editor of the Bell Journal of Economics, and two of the referees turned the paper down and said it wasn't even a proposal for a paper. It was ridiculous. Fortunately, Dean Fama got a hold of it, and he was a co-editor of the JFE at that time. He was in Belgium, and he sent us an unsolicited acceptance. And I said to Bill, I think we're going to have trouble getting it published anywhere else. We'll put it in our journal. We'll make it the lead article. So we now understand the source of this unease and upset. When one's worldview or frames of reference about some important topic or issue are threatened by new knowledge or information, Human beings react with strong emotions, like we're being physically threatened. It's the fight-or-flight response generated by the amygdala in the human brain. Thomas Kuhn documented the common rejection of progress in science in his landmark book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. And boy, he hit it right on the head. So I have two requests. Bear with me, since much of what I'm going to say will not fit your current worldview or frame of reference. If I'm successful, it will shift your worldview to a place from which you will experience more power. Do not try to make it like anything you know in economics or ethics. If you try to make it like something you already know, you will miss what is here for you, and this is difficult. So don't be surprised when you find yourself doing that. Just do your best to stop it. You can judge at the end of the presentation, and you can throw it all away when you walk out the door if you don't find it valuable. So what is integrity? Let's start with the definition from Webster's New World Dictionary. The quality or state of being complete, unbroken condition, wholeness, entirety. The quality or state of being unimpaired, perfect condition, soundness. And you'll notice this one is very light, number three. The quality or state of being of sound moral principle, uprightness, honesty, and sincerity. We're not going to use that in the definition of integrity. So it's basically, think about it as whole and complete, unbroken, unimpaired. So defined this way, integrity is a purely positive phenomenon. It's not a virtue. Nothing inherently good or bad about it. It's just the way the world is, the way an object is, or the way an organization is, or the way a person is. I'm going to show you how morality and ethics are related to integrity. It's really kind of a neat relationship. That'll come down the road a little bit. The long-neglected role of integrity is a factor of production. Economics, finance, and business scholars tend to avoid discussions or considerations of integrity because it occurs to them as normative. When I was at Chicago, to say something was normative was like a mortal sin at the Chicago Business School. Whether you like integrity or not is a normative value judgment on your part. But the effect of integrity or the lack of it on value, productivity, and so on is a positive and is a purely empirical proposition. Our positive link between integrity and value is no more normative than the positive link between a net present value rule for investment decisions and corporate value. Long-run value creation requires integrity as a positive proposition that is testable and potentially refutable. And the positive effects of integrity or its absence on firm performance have too long been invisible in the business community. No kidding. So, the integrity of an object, we'll start there. An object has integrity when it's whole and complete. Any diminution in whole and complete results in a diminution of workability. That should be pretty obvious to all of us. If you take a, say, a bicycle wheel that's not whole and complete, we loosen up some spokes or pull one or two of them out. Now, that's going to affect its workability. It'll become out of round if you put much weight on it and use it, and eventually it may collapse entirely. So its workability, if something is an object, and we're going to go on to people and organizations, when something is not whole and complete, unbroken, unspoiled, its workability is affected. And that intuition will carry all the way through this. So a system has integrity when it's whole and complete. The integrity, workability, performance cascade. When an object is out of integrity, it becomes less workable. Workability is the bridge to performance. As an entity becomes less workable, its opportunity set, the available opportunity for performance, declines. Thus, integrity becomes a necessary but not sufficient condition for maximum performance. Why not sufficient? Because many things affect performance, including, obviously, your mental and physical endowments for people, and for organizations, the competitive, organizational, financial, and human strategy are also important factors. So if all of you got is integrity and nothing else, you're probably not going to have a very productive entity. But if you don't have integrity, it's going to be limited, what you can do. The law of integrity states, As integrity, the state of being whole and complete of an object, system, person, or human entity declines, workability declines, and as workability declines, the opportunity for performance declines. Read that again. As integrity, the state of being whole and complete of an object, system, person, or human entity declines, workability declines, and as workability declines, the opportunity for performance declines. Thus, the maximization of whatever performance measure you choose, including quality of life, requires integrity. Violating the law of integrity generates painful consequences just as surely as violating the law of gravity. Put simply and somewhat overstated, without integrity, nothing works. Think of this as a heuristic on the basis of which I suggest you think about running your life or your organization. If you or your organization operate in life as though this heuristic is true, you're going to find performance increasing dramatically. Huge. And the impact is huge. Easily in the range of 100 to 500%. Now, when I say that to people, they say, he's crazy. You couldn't possibly have increases in performance lying around to be picked up on the order of 100 to 500%. When we started implementing integrity at CERN, S-S-R-N, by the way, since I'm chairman of the company, that's one of the reasons I get all those downloads. And if you live long enough, if you hang around long enough, you can get lots of citations too. So interpret all of that with a grain of salt. But when we started to implement integrity a number of years ago at CERN, over the first 3 years, we saw a 300% increase in productivity. That was real easy to measure because we had no increase in expenditures and we hired one additional person. And total output, total volume tripled. And the people were happy. Now, how can you have that kind of increases in performance lying around and available and nobody knows it? And one of the things that happened at that time was, our biggest expenditure is the technology end. We outsource all of that to an organization called ITX. So when we changed the way we operated, we began to put integrity in the way we interrelated with each other and in the organization. We changed the way we operated with ITX. That caused some disturbance because that meant they had to change. But they adjusted. And what happened was, the CEO of ITX and its founder, Ralph Andrea, after a while, he began to see what was happening because they had to change as we changed. And then he was noticing these huge increases in performance and happiness, the morale of the people that were working with us. It turned out we were their biggest client. What I didn't know was we were their worst client. And so the team that was working with us had huge turnover. People hated it. They were pulling all-nighters all the time, all because of our lack of integrity in the way we dealt with them. And within 6 months of the change that we began to make in the way we related to them, the turnover in the team that was working with us went to zero. Their productivity increased dramatically. Ralph began to see what was going on, and he said, I'm going to implement these principles of integrity at ITX. He did a little differently than we did. He wrote them out, had each person come into his office and sign a form committing to behave this way. The story goes on, but I'll go one step further. And a while later, he said, I'm seeing the same kind of improvements in productivity that you're having, and the people are happier. It's just incredible. He said, one thing I've noticed, Michael, is that I have lots of clients that don't want to behave with integrity. And he had launched a program to teach them how to behave with integrity in relation to them. Another few months, he came back and he said, you know, some clients don't want to introduce integrity in the way they relate to us. And I said, well, what do you do? He said, I fire them. After a while, I just don't want to deal with them. It's too expensive. And I said, well, do you just call them up and tell them you fire them? He said, no. I just keep raising the price until they go away. So, why are the violations of the law of integrity so universally observed? You'll see the causes when we deal with, one, the integrity performance paradox, and two, the veil of invisibility. Again, some new words, new concepts, new language. It sounds weird. Just hang on with it for a while. And I'm going to go through the eight factors, if we have time, that make up the veil of invisibility. But let's start from the integrity of a person. So let's now get down to brass tacks. In this positive model, integrity for a person is a matter of a person's word, nothing more and nothing less. You are a man or a woman of integrity and enjoy the benefits thereof when your word is whole and complete. Your word includes the speaking of your actions, as in actions speak louder than words. Later, we will explicitly define what constitutes one's word in matters of integrity. We don't have to do that at the moment. So integrity is honoring your word. While keeping your word is fundamentally important in life, you will not be able to always keep your word unless you're playing a very small game in life. So for example, if I commit to get up in the morning, to wake up in the morning, I'm playing a pretty small game in life, right? So basically, I'm only going to fail at that once, and then I won't even know. That's a pretty small game. But you can always honor your word. So in fact, the very essence of leadership, which is where all of this started to come about, is being willing to commit to make something happen, to bring something about that nobody, including yourself, knows how to make happen, knows how to accomplish. If you know how to do it, then it's management. If it's leadership, nobody knows how to do it. So if you're going to be a leader in the world, a leader as a researcher, a leader in whatever, you're making commitments to things that are bigger than yourself and that you don't know how to make, how to bring about. So, if you're doing anything other than playing a very small game in life, you're committing to some things that you don't know how to make happen. But you're committed to making it happen anyway. So you may not be able to keep it, but you can always honor your word. What do we mean by honoring your word? Honoring your word is keeping your word, or whenever you will not be keeping your word, just as soon as you become aware that you will not be keeping your word, including not keeping your word on time, saying to everyone impacted, A, that you will not be keeping your word, and B, that you will keep that word in the future and by when, or that you won't be keeping that word at all, and C, what you will do to deal with the impact on others of the failure to keep your word or to keep it on time. In fact, you're putting them back on the same indifference curve in economics language. The power of honoring your word when you will not keep your word. When the literature on trust talks about walking the talk, it says that to be trusted, you must keep your word. However, unless you give your word to virtually nothing, you will not always keep your word. Leadership is all about that. We'll skip through this. Surprising to most people is the fact that you will engender a greater degree of trust and admiration when you do not keep your word, but you do honor your word. This was given to me by a colleague in marketing. This is from Bittner, Booms, and Petriol, the service encounter, diagnosing favorable and unfavorable incidents in the Journal of Marketing, 1990. This is a direct quote. 23.3% of the memorable satisfaction, what they did was in measured and investigated and researched service failures in airlines, restaurants, and hotels. Service failure deliveries. And what they found in this paragraph, or part of the paragraph, summarizes what runs through the whole article. I'll read it to you. 23.3% of the memorable satisfactory encounters involve difficulties attributable to failures in core service delivery. From a management perspective, this finding is striking. It suggests that even service delivery system failures can be remembered as highly satisfactory encounters if they are handled properly. One might expect that dissatisfaction could be mitigated in failure situations if employees are trained to respond, but the fact that such incidents can be remembered as very satisfactory is somewhat surprising. Runs through the whole article. And we found exactly the same thing happening. You know, some of our very best clients at CERN resulted from massive service delivery failures when we first were dealing with them. But when we got our team, our people, knowledgeable and trained to not try and hide it, to fess up to it, to clean up the mess, and it just creates enormous amount of loyalty. And it will in your life too, in your personal life as well as your organizational life. The integrity of an organization. An organization or any human system is in integrity when it's whole and complete with respect to its work. That includes that nothing is hidden, there's no deception, no untruths, no violation of contracts or property rights, and so on. That is to say, an organization honors its work internally between members of the organization and externally between the organization and those it deals with. And that includes what is said by or on behalf of the organization to its members, as well as outsiders. Now, one of the things that had to happen to make integrity work at all in CERN is that as the chairman of the company, at the top of the hierarchy, I had to be willing and invite people to call me up or write me an email when they found that I hadn't kept my word and I hadn't honored my word. Remember what honoring my word is when I'm not going to keep it. As soon as I know I'm going to keep it, I tell you that I'm not going to keep it, and I cleaned up, and I tell you when I am going to keep it, or whether I'm not going to keep it at all, and I clean up the mess that I've caused in your life by not doing that. That's honoring my word. So I have to be willing to have people call me up. Now, I got a lot of telephone calls, it turns out. That wasn't very comfortable. By the way, it does feel warm in here, so if anybody has control, or maybe you can just open the doors at the back, see if we can get some cooler air in. What we're seeing is the evidence of what happens when something's out of integrity. So the air conditioning system is not whole and complete, unbroken, and functioning. And we're hot. So, integrity of a person. Your word defined. This is very important, but I'm not going to go at great lengths into it. You're going to see the beauty of this and the rigor of it as you see what your word is. Word one, there are going to be six of them. It's what you said. Whatever you said you will do or will not do, in the case of doing it on time. Now, there's always some fine print in these, so I'll read it. Note, requests of you become your word unless you have responded to them in a timely fashion. Now, why that? So, what that says is, if somebody writes you an email and says, Mike, I want you to do this, if I don't respond and say I'm not doing that, or I'm not doing it by when you want it, or I'm never doing that, that's my word, and I'm obligated to deliver on it. Why? Because it makes things work. Think about it as simple as that. what you know, whatever you know to do or know not to do, and if it is due, doing it as you know it is meant to be done, and doing it on time unless you have explicitly said to the contrary. So there's no outs. Like you didn't say you wanted it done that way. If you know what it's supposed to be, how it's supposed to be done, then you haven't delivered on it until you do it the way you know. What is expected? Or think about it as what is expected of you as an individual or organization. Now you've got to watch this one carefully. Whatever you are expected to do or not do, these are actually unexpressed requests. In the case of do, doing it on time, unless you have explicitly said to the contrary. So let's make this personal. So what happens, are you married? Yes. So what happens when your spouse expects you to do something, it's an unexpressed request, and you don't deliver? Then you have to justify not doing it. Well, what happens over there with her? What happens in your relationship? It's confidence. And how about anybody else? What happens in your relationship when you don't deliver on what your spouse expects you to do?
Problems.
That's what happens in my relationship. So, here's a way. Now, so imagine what we're saying here. Anyone that has unexpressed requests of you in the form of expectations, are your word unless you explicitly decline them. So that says it's your responsibility. You are accountable for, if you want to have a workable relationship with anybody in your life, your boss, your subordinates, your husband, your wife, your mother, your brother, your sister. Everybody sees it in their families. So, are your word unless you explicitly decline them? So, Sue is my partner. Sometimes I'll say to her, Sue, I have a sense you're expecting something of me in this domain. You know, less travel or something like that. And she says, she'll say whatever they are. And then sometimes I may say, well, I'm going to adjust it a little. I'm not going to go to Istanbul. Well, actually, that one I did come to. But sometimes I say, well, okay, I won't do that. I'll do something else. I'll stay at home. Or I may say, I'm never doing that. Now, that's going to generate an uncomfortable conversation, right? But nowhere as uncomfortable as if I had just ignored it and violated her expectations. Is that making any sense to anybody? I see a lot of blank faces. This is concerning. Because this is important to your home life. And either you're saying what he's saying will never work with my spouse or my mother or my kids. It will work. And if you want to have a wonderful relationship with anybody in your life, reports, direct reports in the office, superiors, your bosses, your wife, your kids, your parents, if you make yourself cause of the matter of their expectations, i.e. unexpressed requests, it doesn't do any good to say you never told me that. That doesn't do any good. Because they're still disappointed and they're angry and it affects the whole relationship. But take it out of the home and put it into the business environment, the academic environment. Are we fulfilling the unexpressed requests of our students? I'm not saying that you have to fulfill them, but you got to either fulfill them or say what you are going to do, or you're not going to do it at all. And that'll create an interesting discussion, but man, that relationship is going to work in a way that it never worked before. And when you do that in an organization as a whole, it's absolutely incredible what that small thing will bring about. Now, note, there's a note here in fine print. What you expect of others, your unexpressed requests of others, is not for you their word. So what's good for the goose is not good for the gander. Why? Because that makes it work. So you, as an individual, if you want to be in integrity, don't run around with unexpressed requests of others. Make them explicit. And ask for an answer. You know, will you do this? I want you to do that. And he or she or your boss or your direct reports may say, I'm not going to do that, or I'll do something else. But you'll get it resolved, and getting it resolved in advance and then living up to the solution by honoring that word will bring about a state change that is absolutely incredible in terms of the workability. So, what you say is so. Whenever you have given your word to others as to the existence of something or state of the world, your word includes being willing to be held accountable that the others would find your evidence makes what you have asserted valid for themselves. By the way, the air conditioning did come on, so it helped. We expressed our expectations about a cool room. Made it explicit that something happened. Now, so let me relate this one to finance. I have written a number of papers on earnings management, and it's become a fashionable topic over the last 10 years. And, you know, what's going on with earnings management is outright lying. And it's become endemic in our business. And we're turning out students that can't tell the difference. And we justify it. I've sat in board meetings with perfectly honest people, upstanding people, who engage in discussions about earnings management, and I can tell you the details, but I won't. Because I wouldn't reveal the organization, but we don't have time. But you've all experienced it in one way or another, or you've read about it. And I see perfectly upstanding board members sitting around having a discussion about earnings management. And if they were having a discussion about how much they were going to lie about earnings, that discussion would not take place. But that's what's going on. And that discussion is violating this proposition. Whenever you have given your word to others, like in the financial reports, you're the CEO of the board, as to the existence of something or state of the world, like our earnings, your word includes being willing to be held accountable that the others would find your evidence makes what you have asserted valid for them. That allows no room for game playing in reporting. Because if I actually told you what we did to make the earnings turn out that way, you would say, that's not the earnings. I remember one board meeting I was in. The managers were within a hair's breadth of earning their hurdle bonus. And this was in the September meeting. But it wasn't guaranteed. So what they did was announce a price increase. This was in the durable goods industry, effective as of January 1. You know, we all know what that's going to do to product demand. They're going to shift demand from the first quarter of next year into the fourth quarter of this year. And sure enough, that went on, but it wasn't enough. It wasn't enough to actually get them over the hurdle. So then we experienced the largest loss in the history of the company, largest quarterly loss in the history of the company. Because then we were for sure going to make the hurdle bonus in the first quarter of the next year. And we've all seen examples of this. Now, I call that line, people get upset when I say that, but this is a more gentle way of putting it, that's a violation of word four. If I gave you all of the evidence of what we were doing, by the way, we didn't announce to the public that, then you wouldn't believe the earnings forecast. So there's a lot of power in this, and by the way, it has a lot of power in our own personal lives. So I'll say what it is again. So I'm going to make some assertion, I'm not going to give you the evidence, but I'm willing to be held accountable by you that if I give you all of the evidence that you might ask for, you will come to the same conclusion I came to without the evidence. Okay. Word five, what you stand for, whether expressed in the form of a declaration made to one or more people or to yourself, as well as what you hold yourself out to others as standing for, formally declared or not. Now, we all do that in various ways. I'm not going to spend a long time discussing it. No, this is your word, not integrity. Keeping your word. You keep your word by doing what you said you would do and doing it on time. Doing what you know to do and doing it the way it was meant to be done and on time unless you have said you would not do so. Doing what others would expect you to do even if you have never said you would do it, and doing it on time unless you have said you would not do it. And you've made your expectations of others clear to them by making explicit requests. And you're willing to be held accountable when you assert something that others would accept your evidence on the issue as valid. I mean, just think about what would happen if all of us ran our lives that way, at the office, in the home, in our universities. Word six, the relation between my word, morality, ethics, and legality. I'm going to do this very briefly. Morality, ethics, and legality are all about right and wrong, good and bad behavior. They are the standards for good and bad behavior. The social moral standards, the group ethical standards, and the governmental legal standards of right and wrong, good and bad behavior, in the society, groups, and state in which I enjoy the benefits of membership, are also part of my word. Word six, what I am expected to do by the customs, by the laws, all right? Unless I've explicitly and publicly expressed my intention to not keep one or more of them, because they're either formal requests or implicit requests. And I'm willing to bear the costs, including punishment, of refusing to conform to these standards, the rules of the game I make. In fact, if I do that, I have honored my word with respect to these standards. In summary, morality, ethics, and legality are part of your word by your mere presence, unless you explicitly say that you do not give your word to one or more of those rules. That converts the word of others that is imposed on you to your word, an enormous difference. To be in integrity, you must inform all those in the game you are playing when you are not going to follow one or more of the rules of the game. I just want you to think about the workability this generates. You don't have to follow the rules of the game you're in, but you need to inform everybody that's playing with you which ones you're not going to abide by. Gandhi is an example. He was explicit about the rules he would not follow and was willing to bear the consequences. And he changed the lives of over a billion people. That's the secret part of the nonviolent movement. A major puzzle. Why is it that almost everyone acts without integrity in one way or another, despite the huge cost it imposes on them? Also imposes costs on other people, but it imposes costs on us, me personally, when I'm out of integrity. Sobering thought. Everyone in this room sees themselves as persons of integrity. including me, at least before I started to do this work. Bad news. I can say with great confidence that no one in this room is a person completely in integrity, including me, and I know that for sure. That self-satisfied view is one of the causes of the universal lack of integrity in the world. I don't repeat, the common belief that we have made it is one of the factors contributing to the lack of integrity in the world and in our lives. The fact is, integrity is a mountain with no top, so we better get used to and even like climbing. And the higher we get, the better off things work. With all the critical elements of this new model of integrity on the table, we can see how difficult it is to be fully in integrity as a person or organization. One would have to be in integrity with respect to every instance of words 1 through 6 in one's life at each moment in time. What you said, what you know to do or not to do, what is expected of you, unexpressed request of you, by each of those with whom you wish to have a workable relationship, unless you have explicitly declined that expectation. What you say is so. What you stand for. The moral, ethical, and legal codes of each and every society, group, and governmental entity of which you are a member. Thus, we better enjoy climbing because this is a mountain with no top. Notice that every time we put something into integrity in our lives or organizations, workability and the opportunity for performance increase. Guaranteed. The effect is huge, and yet we will never get it all done. The costs of dealing with an object, person, group, or entity that is out of integrity. This is very important. Consider the experience of dealing with an object that lacks integrity, say a car or a bicycle or an air conditioning system. When it's not whole and complete and unbroken, that is, a component is missing or malfunctioning, it becomes unreliable, unpredictable, and it creates those characteristics in our lives. The car fails in traffic, we create a traffic jam, we're late for appointments, we fail to perform, we disappoint our partners, associates, and firms. In effect, the out-of-integrity car creates a lack of integrity in our life with all sorts of unworkability fallout. And this is true of all of our associations with persons, groups, or organizations that are out of integrity. The effects are huge, but generally attributed to something other than the lack of integrity. So, I'm not saying that we shouldn't associate ourselves with organizations or people that are out of integrity. Just understand when you do, those associations are going to lend that to your life. There's no way to avoid it. No way. The easy example is the cop. The harder example to deal with is an addicted child or relative or an organization if you want to deal with for some reason or another, but they're out of integrity. It will lend that, those characteristics to you in your life, in your organizations. Since we're all out of integrity to one degree or another, you just have to take into account whether the relationship is worth it. But it will cause you to think differently about those choices. I'm not going to go through these in detail. We show up late, we're not prepared for meetings, don't show up at all. We surreptitiously read documents, answer emails, work on other matters while in meetings. That one I'll say a little bit more about. The Microsoft and the people in Microsoft pride themselves on being able to multi-process, just as I used to. Why am I going into details about what looks like simple-minded real stuff? Because it's out of integrity and it creates unworkability. Not whole and complete. And the impact of this stuff is gigantic because nobody is capable of multi-process, in spite of the fact that most of us think we can. So you can read these. The cheating and corporate officers not enforcing their managers not honoring their word, not honoring their company's word, corporate officers stealing from the company,
on and on and on. Catholic priests sexually abusing children, doctors abusing their patients and defrauding Medicare, lawyers committing fraud in the practice of law, plagiarism. Some clues, out of integrity behavior in organizations. You hear this kind of language going on? There's out of integrity behavior. Win at any cost. Everyone else is doing it. We've always done it. This is the way this business works. If we don't do it, somebody else will. Nobody's hurt by it. It doesn't matter how it gets done as long as it gets done. It works, so let's not ask too many questions. No one's going to notice. It's legal, but it's too expensive or it takes too much time. Anytime you hear that kind of language going on, there's out of integrity, actions taking place. Everybody believes that it's making them better off, but it's doing exactly the opposite, and it's all invisible. It won't be invisible when you leave this room, hopefully. So now I want to talk about the veil of invisibility. Almost all people in organizations fail to see the cost imposed by the violations of law and integrity. How can that happen? How can we have 300 to 500% increases in productivity and happier people lying around with possibilities on the table and not notice it? That's a real puzzle. This is not 10%. You know, you tell somebody that you can double, triple, quintuple the output of the organization at zero cost increase, and if people are going to be happier, then they'll say you're crazy. No, the people who believe that are crazy. Because they can't see it. It's the bear in their life that they can't see. The unworkability generated by the lack of integrity occurs to people and organizations as a consequence of something other than violations of the law of integrity. For most of us, the breakdowns and confusion that is the mess in our lives is just the way life is, like water to the fish and air to the birds. Most people rationalize or explain the mess in their organizations and in their lives without getting to the out of integrity behavior that is the actual source. This state of affairs is an example of you cannot manage what is undistinguished. Therefore, it will run you. Remember that. If there's something in your life that's undistinguished in the sense that you can't see it, there's no way to perceive it, you can't hear it, you cannot manage it. And that means it's running you. You are helpless. And we've all had experiences, those of us that are older in the room at least, on occasion in our lives in which we finally see something in our lives that we never saw before, that maybe our personal lives or our business lives, that was running us. And with relatively small adjustment, we could make a change that made a huge difference in the world. It came out of the closet. It came from invisible to visible. And that's what this integrity stuff is all about. I just gave you an example. In my multi-processing, in the CERN board meetings, I could keep you here for hours. And I have blamed other people for it. Okay? I was the cause. When I finally saw it. So, cost of the lack of integrity and the veil of invisibility. This is very important. Integrity performance paradox. People in organizations, while committed to performance, systematically sacrifice integrity in the name of increasing performance and thereby reduce performance. Now that's nonsense. But it goes on all the time. It's the bear in your life. How can this occur? If operating with integrity is so productive, why do people systematically sacrifice their integrity and suffer the consequences? And why are they blind to these effects? We're going to go through 8 factors to generate this. And if you master these, each of these factors, your life will change. I guarantee it. In ways that you never expected. First, seeing integrity as a virtue. For most people in organizations, integrity exists as a virtue rather than as a necessary condition for performance. As a virtue, integrity is easily sacrificed when it appears a person or an organization must do so to succeed. For many people, virtue is valued only to the degree that it engenders the admiration of others, and as such, it is easily sacrificed, especially when it would not be noticed or can be rationalized. Sacrificing integrity as virtue seems no different than sacrificing courteousness, or to be ridiculous, or new sinks in the men's room. You know, it just doesn't seem like it matters. So I can sacrifice it a little. And since it's invisible, we don't see how it's biting us. Number two, self-deception about our own out-of-integrity behavior. People generally do not see when they're out of integrity. In fact, they are mostly unaware that they've not kept their word and they have not honored it. What they see is the reason, rationalization, or excuse for not keeping their word. Like, that one is big in my life. I've always got a reason. Now I catch myself saying, no, I gave my word. Now I got to clean up the mess. The reason doesn't suffice. Being sincere about something doesn't suffice. Dealing with somebody that's sincere and they don't deliver is equivalent to dealing with somebody that's an outright liar. You cannot tell the difference in the behavior and the results. In fact, people systematically deceive, lie to themselves about who they have been and what they've done. As my colleague Chris Argyris, loving, after 4 decades of studying human nature, concludes, put simply, people consistently act inconsistently, unaware of the contradiction between their espoused theory and their theory in use, between the way they think they are acting and the way they really act, in his article, Teaching Smart People How to Learn in the Harvard Business Review. Brilliant piece. And if you think this is not you, you are fooling yourself about fooling yourself. Guaranteed. I should have had a warning issued in some places in this talk would be a little uncomfortable. But when you actually get, you see some of your actions in here, it will make a huge difference in your life. And I want you to know I've committed every one of these. Big time. And I'm still a work in progress. Because people cannot see their out of integrity behavior, it is impossible for them to see the cause of the unworkability in their lives and organizations, the direct result of their own violations of the law of integrity. Think about those referees' reports that aren't back on time. I know that's getting dirty. Relating to integrity is keeping one's word. The belief that integrity is keeping one's word, period, leaves no way to maintain integrity when it's not possible, or when it is inappropriate, or one simply chooses not to keep one's word. For example, I give my word to you, Andrew, and it turns out you have to die in order for me to keep that word. So it would be inappropriate for me to do that, because I value you. And so, yeah, so I'm not going to do that, and so I got to clean up the mess I've caused in your life. So there are lots of times it's going to be absolutely inappropriate for you to keep your word. Don't avoid it. Clean up the mess. Put them back on the indifference curve that they would be. And do it as soon as you recognize that that's going to happen. So what I'm saying is there, when you're talking about keeping your word, it's absolutely appropriate to do a cost-benefit analysis on keeping your word. Totally appropriate. And that leads to concealing, not keeping one's word, which adds to the veil of invisibility about the impact of violations of the law of integrity. And to carry with you all of these incompletions. Number four, not seeing that integrity is a mountain with no top. To the extent that people are aware of integrity and the cost of out-of-integrity behavior, they systematically believe that they are in integrity. Or if not in integrity at any moment, they believe they can puts themselves back into integrity and be a person of complete integrity. Actually getting that integrity is a mountain with no top, and therefore we better learn to enjoy climbing, leaves us as individuals with power. Knowing that we will never get there opens us up to tolerance of and an ability to see and deal productively with our own out-of-integrity behavior, as well as that of others. Number five, fear. The fear of announcing that you are not going to keep your word. When maintaining your integrity, acknowledging that you are not, there's not a person in this room that isn't subject to this. So read it carefully. When maintaining your integrity, acknowledging that you are not going to keep your word and clean up the mess that results, occurs for you as a threat to be avoided, like it was when you were a child, rather than simply a challenge to be dealt with, then you will find it difficult to maintain your integrity. When not keeping your word, most people fear the possibility of looking bad and the consequent loss of power and respect. They choose the apparent short-term gain of avoiding that fear by hiding that they will not keep their word. This conceals the long-term loss caused by violations of the law of integrity. Thus, out of fear, we're blinded to and therefore mistakenly forfeit the power and respect that accrues from acknowledging that one will not keep one's word or that one has not kept one's word. And the interesting thing about it is that the people you're acknowledging that to, whether it's an organization or an individual, and whether it's the organization that's acknowledging that they're not going to keep their word, if you announce it in advance, it's a world of difference for them. You'll find out it's not a matter of shame. Especially if you accompany with it, what are you going to do to make up for the fact that you're not keeping your word? It's so unusual in people's lives, they say, wow, CERN is really an interesting organization. Like, try it. You will find that reaction, I guarantee, and the clarity that will come in your mind is amazing. Integrity is not seen as a factor of production. That leads people to make up false causes and unfounded rationalizations as the source or sources of failure, which in turn conceals the violation of the law of integrity as the source of the reduction of the opportunity for performance that results in failure. Number seven, these get a little bit complicated. Not doing a cost-benefit analysis on giving one's word. This is fairly straightforward. When giving their word, most people do not consider fully what it will take to keep that word. That is, people do not do a cost-benefit analysis on giving their word. And in fact, when giving their word, most people are merely sincere, that is, well-meaning, or placating someone, and don't even think about what it will take to keep their word. This failure to do a cost-benefit analysis on giving one's word is irresponsible. Such irresponsible giving of one's word is a major source of the mess left in the lives of people and organizations. Indeed, people often do not even know they have given their word. People generally do not see the giving of their word as, I am going to make this happen. If you're not doing this, you will be out of integrity for sure. Generally, people give their word intending to keep it. That is, they're merely sincere, and oftentimes not even that. They say, yeah, let's have lunch next week. How many times have you done that in your life with the equivalent? Yeah, I have no intention of having lunch next week. Or I'll call you sometime. Or, well, you make up your own stories. I got enough in my life. If anything makes it difficult or even inconvenient to deliver, then we provide reasons instead of results. No real difference in dealing with an outright liar. When somebody's dealing with me, when I'm behaving that way, there's no real difference than if I was an outright liar just rather than being sincere. Number eight, doing a cost-benefit analysis is on honoring one's word. I think I said earlier, I just drove me crazy for a year. How could cost-benefit analysis not work? People almost universally apply cost-benefit analysis to honoring their word. Treating integrity as a matter of cost-benefit analysis guarantees you will not be a trustworthy person. And with a small exception, guarantees you will not be a person of integrity. So how does that work? If I apply cost-benefit analysis to honoring my word, I'm either out of integrity to start with because I have not stated the cost-benefit contingency that is in fact part of my word. That is, I lied if I didn't tell you I was going to do a cost-benefit analysis. Or to have integrity when I give my word, I must say something like the following. I will honor my word when it comes time for me to honor my word if the costs of doing so are less than the benefits. Now, just think about that. You're all economists. So what have I just told you? I've told you that my word is worth nothing. Absolutely nothing. But that's going to leave me with integrity, but it's not going to engender trust. And in fact, I just told you that I'm an unmitigated opportunist. My word means nothing. Because when I get around to having to honor it, if and when I don't keep it, then I'm going to do a cost-benefit analysis, and then the cost of less than the benefits of honoring it, then I'll honor it. But I was going to do that anyway, right? So the only time it really matters is whether the costs are more than the benefits. Then you can pound on my word. That's what it means to be a man or a woman of your word after you give it. Now, you don't have to keep it, but you do have to honor it. Be careful to keep that distinction, because thinking that you have to keep your word is one of the reasons why we all get in trouble in this domain. And I'm going to skip through these. If I take on integrity as who I am, then I should and will think carefully before I give my word, and I will recognize I'm putting myself at risk when I do so. And I will never give my word to two or more things that are mutually inconsistent. In a very real sense, being a person of integrity starts with me giving my word to myself. My word to myself that I am a person of integrity. And it took me about a year and a half or two to get to this realization. And when I do that, I say to myself, I am going to make this happen. Not, I'm going to try to make this happen, or I hope this will happen. As my grandsons helped me find out, as Jedi Master Yoda says to Luke Skywalker in Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, do or not do, there is no try. Very profound. There is no try. Try and pick up the glass. You either pick up the glass or you don't pick up the glass. There is no try. Integrity is privately optimal. Integrity is something one does for oneself. It is actionable and does not require the cooperation of others. There's a major confusion. It pays one to behave with integrity even if those around you do not, because those around you will trust you, and that is valuable to you. Integrity is privately optimal and does not make one into a Pollyanna or a patsy that can be preyed upon. Because you behave with integrity does not mean that you trust those around you who do not behave with integrity. You are not a Pollyanna or a patsy. The result is workability, greater performance, greater value, and joy. Just try it out. It works. It does not work when you're dealing with people that have no integrity to think that the only way you can get along with them is to have no integrity yourself. You won't trust them. What is it like to be whole and complete as a person? When you're on your word to yourself and others, you're at peace with yourself. This is the part that no economist will get. It took me a couple of years. But it really is important. You are at peace with yourself and therefore act from a place where you are at peace with others in the world, even those you disagree with or might threaten you. You live without fear for your selfhood, that is, who you are as a person. There's no fear of losing the admiration of others. You do not have to be right. You act with humility. Everything or anything that someone else might say is okay for consideration. No need to defend or explain yourself or rationalize yourself. You're able to learn. It's often mistaken as mere self-confidence rather than the true courage that comes from being whole and complete. That is, being a man or a woman of integrity. And it's a critically important element of being a leader. A picture of integrity. What would your life be like, and what would your performance be, if it were true that you have done what you said you would do and you did it on time? You've done what you know to do and you did it the way it was meant to be done and you did it on time. You have done what others would expect you to do, even if you never said you would do it, and you did it on time, or you have informed them that you will not meet their expectations. And you have informed others of your expectations for them and have made explicit requests to those others. And whenever you realize that you are not going to do any of the foregoing and not going to do it on time, you have said so to everyone who might be impacted, and you did so as soon as you realized that you wouldn't be doing it or wouldn't be doing it on time. And if you were going to do it in the future, you have said by when you would do it. And you have dealt with the consequences of your not doing it on time or not doing it at all for those who are impacted by you not doing it on time or not doing it at all. In a sentence, you've done what you said you would do or you've said you are not doing it. You have nothing hidden. You are truthful, forthright, straight, and honest. And you have cleaned up any mess you have caused for those depending on your word. Pretty interesting place to be in life. And almost unimaginable, what if others operated in this way with you? What a world. And that is possible. Not like tomorrow. We can all be that way. I've been at this for, I don't know, more than 10 years now. I have a long ways to go. But man, what a difference it's made in my personal life. What a difference it's made in CERN. It really has brought peace to my life. And the only way I have of simply summarizing that, you know, I'm now 72 years old. I'm not going to be around forever. But I don't have any incompletions in my life, or very few. And I have a lot to do. But if I died tomorrow, that would be okay. Because things are pretty much complete. No, I'd be disappointed that I wouldn't get all that stuff done there in longer times. Now, that leaves one with a great deal of peace. And it all comes from thinking this way about life and cleaning up the messes or not causing a lot of messes. By the way, if you talk to Sue, she'll tell you I still cause a lot of messes. That's because it's a mountain with no top. But man, it really does make a difference. And I know it sounds crazy to you because you can't see it. It is the bear in our lives. And it can begin to open up for you in little ways. And in your organizations, it's unbelievable the impact it's had on some. And the people in CERN. And a big part of that has to be that every single one of us, at the top, Greg Gordon, me, others, have to be willing to have people call us up, write us emails. I got two this morning, saying, you know, you gave me your word, you were going to do this, and I don't think you did it. So then I write back. I got to write back and say, yep, I'm out of integrity. I'm going to be busy cleaning up the mess after I get the talk done today. And after dinner and after wine. I have to be honest, I didn't tell him about that part. Anyway, so that's it, all I have to say. Are there any questions or comments? We're close with time. Yes, sir. I'll repeat the question. Would the talk go better, or the paper go better, if I took account of Chris's statement about the nature of human beings, that we're all hardwired to con ourselves into believing that we're acting? I did, because that's what it is. It's conning ourselves into believing that we're doing X when we're not doing X. That's his main point. Well, then you may be talking about something else Chris has said, but not the point I was talking about here. And I understand what you're saying, and I'm sorry for misinterpreting it. Thank you for giving the... we're hardwired to do a lot of bad stuff. And what we don't see is how it hurts us. And what I'm giving you is a model that if you take it on, you will find out it shifts the way the world occurs to you, and you will quit hitting yourself with a hammer on your other hand. Because that's what you're doing. That's what I do. Still, less of it than I used to. And the reason we did that and are doing it is because it's invisible to us. The way we see the world. And what I and my co-author, Werner Erhard, have done, and we're writing a book on it and make it available in more detail, is to create a way to look at the world in which this behavior becomes clear and its consequences become clear, in which we can then have a way better chance of actually choosing to alter our behavior so we quit hitting ourselves with a hammer. It's just that simple. Now, but saying it's simple doesn't mean it's easy. So I think that's part of your point. It's not easy. But I'm agreeing with you. We are hardwired to behave in this counterproductive way and not see it. So what I spent is a couple of hours with you helping you see it. Now it's your choice. Keep hitting yourself with the hammer? Or stop something. Try it out.
Whereby you need network supports to provide contrary views to each other to find the truth.
I'm not willing to take that on yet. This I can do. I don't see any benefit from using the word tensegrity, as I told you a year ago. And I could be totally wrong about that. What I do know from what I see happen in organizations and what I see happen with people is emails I get from people in sessions like this, that it brings about a gigantic change in some people's lives. And I see it in my own life. Now, you had a question. So I'm just open about the 10-second email.
Well, thank you very much. That's really probably one of the most remarkable keynote speech I have witnessed, and I remember you for several years and a couple of keynote speeches, and probably this one I will remember for quite some time now.
I think I've fallen in love with you.
No, nothing.
It's okay.
One thing I will disagree, even though this one is so systematic, in absolute axiomatic type of form, so logical, rigorously developed theory. One thing I would disagree, it's weird. No, it's not weird. It's probably subtle. And probably talking about visibility and seeing every line of the sense is only just not good enough. So the person has to be ready. And my question is with regards to your final point. What if others operate in this way? So what are really the channels? What are the pathways to make other people do it?
You can't
just, to finish that.
Yeah.
Like for example, if you're meeting person, or if you just go to a meeting and you're smiling, or even on the street, smile to an unknown person, you receive a smile back.
Yeah.
It's not the same, obviously. So it's much more difficult to.
Right.
Yes, you can do it for yourself, you can do it for your organization, you can somehow establish a culture and following probably. Students, that's our role in the life. So we can educate, we can put this one in a very solid framework.
This,
the talk is the condition.
Excellent point. And what I can tell you from my observation, it seems to be contagious. This is an area for empirical work that would be enormously important. It seems to be catching. I will warn you, you have to be very careful about going to work on somebody else to put their integrity in. Be very careful about that. I'm going to put it in a very crude way. You can't pee for somebody else, and you can't put somebody else's integrity in. Now, I know that's crude, but it makes the point very good. And if you go about that in a way that doesn't give people a choice, if you help them see it, and they choose to go down that road, great. And they even learn, as I told you, what happened was ITX learned from dealing with us. And they said, I didn't tell them they should do that. They said, wow, that makes a difference. Let's do some of that. And it does seem to have a viral character to it. Because it wasn't too long after they, at ITX, began to put it in. Ralph was a member of the Young Entrepreneurs Organization or something like that. And suddenly he's on the phone saying, Mike, would you come to Rochester and give your integrity talk to this young president's organization, whatever it is. He's, I said, sure. Well, so there is this, just be careful. I don't have this, the answer to this down very pat, but you can refer people to the talk, you can explain some of it, you can actually start behaving differently and people will notice and they say, gee, I'd like some of that. But don't make them wrong about it. I'm telling you, that will get them defensive and you'll get nowhere. Maybe that's the best advice I can give you. Because if you start running around, I can say it here to the group as a whole, when I also say, I am, like all everybody else in this room, out of integrity. Because none of us is ever going to get there, to the top of that mountain. And when you actually get that, it makes a difference in your ability to deal with other people. That are, like all of us, out of integrity to one degree or another. And what I do observe is that it has this viral characteristic. It seems to be catching. And in the right circumstances, in the right relationship, you can gently do some coaching with other people. But be very, very careful about that because it can go haywire on you and you turn them off. And if they're loved ones, as they likely are going to be, or beloved colleagues in an organization, there you can make it part of what we've done at CERN is make it part of the culture of the organization. And so I have to be willing to be called on it, and people are able to tolerate it when we call each other on it. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I just have a question. I appreciate what you've been saying, and when I used to teach management, I had a give model.
Somehow the mic is not on, or you're not speaking close enough to it.
Hello? Is
that there we go.
Okay. I used to teach a give model, which is get grounded, have vision, bring intention, and empower, which I think summarizes in a different way integrity. But one of my questions is, can you help us bring this concept, the way we define our economic model? I mean, right from the beginning, I know that closed form solutions are more important than the reality and our assumptions. So my memory of my first graduate economics course, granted a long time ago, was that the first principle was assume free disposal. And now we have a world that's suffering from pollution, because in order to get a perfectly functioning economic model that's efficient, we had to throw out the whole concept of waste and pollution. Can we bring integrity to the way we actually look at the world that we live in?
Sure. Just look at where it's not whole and complete.
Can I add to that?
Yeah, please.
Can I just add
Just wait until she brings it. There you go.
Yeah, just adding to what the lady just said.
Yeah.
Is it not because the very first thing that you started was that integrity is when you are whole.
And complete.
And complete.
Unbroken, unspoiled.
That may lead us now to rethink what whole is, what complete is. Because so far in this world that we are living in at the moment, where capitalism is reigning supreme, is where we see that the highest, most profitable organization in the world, the firm with the greatest market value, is the whole, is the complete. Maybe there is a need for us to redefine this whole, this complete, not just in the economic organizational life, but in our personal life, because we are all, these expectations are conditioned by the situation and the system that we live in.
Right.
So maybe there is a need to change this entire system and this concept of whole and complete.
You're going about it in the wrong way. Let me just say, I know we're pressed for time, so I'm being a little impatient. I told you, I defined very precisely and very rigorously what whole and complete is. It's whole and complete with your word. And there are six definitions, six aspects of your word. Go back, look at the slides. There's an older version of this talk up on CERN. This one will be up next week sometime when I get back. Go back and look at it carefully. It's all there. You want to go off in some other direction. Now, that may be a productive way to do it, but it's not integrity. Okay? I have defined integrity for you in a way that's whole and complete and has to do with your work. And I'm telling you, it's absolutely airtight. Now, that doesn't mean it'll solve all of the problems in the world. And yes, it ought to be a part of economics. And if I had my way, what I said early on is 10 years from now, this is not all that different when I gave that first talk on agency problems. That was a heretical way to think. Now, you've been much more positive response than we got in the early days of that. But a lot of people and a lot of economists aren't so positively inclined. Well, that's fine. They'll figure it out eventually. But it's a different language. It comes from a different place. Well, let me say something really controversial. That I'll repeat what I said earlier in the talk. You know, behavioral economics and behavioral finance have had an enormous impact on the world. They will not and have not paid any attention to this. And it is the giant bear in the living room of the behavioral stuff. This thing is gigantic in every one of our personal lives and in every organization and every society. And it's invisible. And the so-called elite scholars are absolutely unwilling to look at it. Why? because it doesn't, I've been through this a number of times, it doesn't fit the language, it comes, you know, there's no journal editors, we'll turn it down. I submitted a paper to the NBER, I've been a member of the NBER for years, 35 years now, and I submitted an earlier version of one of these things to the NBER. And it couldn't be in the NBER working paper series because it said it didn't have anything to do with economics. You know, I think that's going to get solved in the next 6 months, but you just have to understand. So this is free, gratuitous advice on my part. For those of you who might get excited about this and you go out, look at it more carefully and do your own work on it, and I hope you do, I hope lots of people do that. Don't be shocked when people say to you, that doesn't make any sense. That doesn't fit our worldview. We don't have any frame of reference that allows for that. In impolite language, they'll say it's bullshit. And it sounds like that to them. And I believe if you take this stuff and you begin to apply it to the problems that you are legitimately worried about, and you really look at what whole and complete with your word is in that domain. I mean, if we're dumping sewage into the lakes and rivers and we're putting gases into the air, that's not whole and complete. Okay, and it's out of integrity and it's causing damage. This gives you a different way to look at it. And you can look at it in all kinds of ways. You can look at it in your personal lives, as I've mentioned. You can look at it in your organizational lives. You can look at it in terms of public policy. It has widespread implications. And my experience so far is that every time where I've been involved and I get people to look at problems they're dealing with in this context, it doesn't mean that everything is an integrity problem, but it will open things up in a way that oftentimes is enormously productive. I'll give you a simple thing. I didn't go through it today because of the time constraints, but if you look at a system, in order for it to be whole and complete, or you look at a piece of machinery, the design of the, there are three aspects of it. The design of it has to be capable of producing what the intention of the design was. The actual implementation of the design has to be faithful to the design. If it's implemented badly, it's not going to work. And finally, it has to be put to the use that it was originally intended for, that the design was intended for. Now that's something, just making that tripartite distinction has had a huge impact on our ability to debug our systems at CERN. Why? I'll give you a simple one. Simple reason. One of the things that we saw after we began to look at it this way is that, well, let me give you an example, where the use is not consistent with the design. That's like a 300-pound man trying to make use of a life preserver designed for a 50-pound child. He's going to drown if he doesn't swim. Okay, now it turns out we had all kinds of that stuff going on at CERN. That we were using things for something that they were never designed for. And it didn't work. Surprise, surprise. But we never thought about it that way. And once we actually thought about it, well, what was this designed for? What is it being used for? And we had all kinds of 300-pound men trying to use a 50-pound life preserver, and our systems weren't working. So that simple distinction gives you, they weren't whole and complete. And it gave us enormous leverage, dramatic improvements in productivity, and vast reductions in cost.